Hey guys, welcome to the vlog. So I'm trying out some new software to record this vlog, and sorry I haven't been on lately. It's been quite busy lately. But yeah, it's been incredibly busy. And yes, I am smoking my pipe again, mostly because I am out of cigars. And I didn't stop to buy those cheap gas station cigars either. So, just kind of weird. It's a delay, and so I'm kind of watching myself being recorded, and there's a small delay, so it's kind of throwing me off my game a little bit. Not that I have much game, but I don't know, it's late. It's very late. I'm late, right? So, quick little update. I won that auction, and I got the racket. I'll show you that in a second after I fix this pipe issue. And my pipe tool. And forget that pipe lighter, I'm using my Angry Critic lighter. Much better. So yeah, I won the racket. Here it is. It's the Wilson K-Factor 6-1 Tour 90. It weighs about 12 ounces unstrung without the overgrip. It's got a leather grip underneath the overgrip, and it's in great shape for what I got it for. I got it for about $100. That included shipping, and so it was a good deal for the shipping too. I've hit with it once, and I've only hit with it for about 5 minutes. even though I've had it for about a week, I just haven't had the time to go out to the courts yet to really try this out. But so far I've liked every minute with it, all of the 5 minutes, just because I love the response and the crispness of the of it. It's got about a 67 stiffness rating, which is about the stiffness rating, I think it's actually the identical stiffness rating of my racket of choice, and the swing weight is about the same as my racket as well. It's got a 336 swing weight, my racket's got a 335 swing weight, not that much difference. But it's got a thinner beam, so it's thinner than my racket. So it's got a little, and plus the smaller head size. My racket's a 97 square inch head size. This is a 90 square inch head size. So this has got significantly less power than my racket, but it's also got a little bit more control than mine. So I can put the ball on a dime when I'm on the sweet spot with this thing. I can put the ball on a dime. I can do pretty much, like, the control with my racket of choice is not so different, where I can't do that with my racket. It's got a little bit more, but this one's just a little bit more consistent to be able to put it on a dime, though my racket has a little bit more forgiveness to it, so. But it's definitely going to be fun to take out coaching with. And definitely just hitting around with friends, it's definitely going to be a fun racket to do that with. So I am looking forward to getting more playing time in with it. And I love the cosmetic of it. So Yeah, I'm really gonna enjoy playing with this. And now I can scratch one racket off my list of rackets to that I want to collect. But other than that, it's just been very, very busy. I haven't done laundry in a while. I gotta go do that. I'm out of black clothing. So, on to old hand-me-downs and clothes that I don't mind smoking in, because, quite frankly, I don't mind ruining this if some tobacco gets on it. And sorry, once again, this vlog is so late. Like I said, I've been just going through a lot of things with school, trying to make sure, that I'm going to graduate at some point. Having two majors and a minor might not have been my best idea, but I know I'll graduate at some point. I'm working a little bit more hours. Starting this week and going forward at Sports Story, I'm going to be working about 30 hours a week on top of the gas station job, so that's another 8 hours. So I'll be working in probably on average about 40 hours a week going through the vacation. Luckily, it's just 40 hours, and my time there stops. Some people say school is easier than work because you're only in school for like 6 hours a day. I'm like, yeah, no, not true, because you end up with about 2 hours worth of homework at the end of the day. So, yeah, it's going to be nice not having school while I'm working. So, and I'm sorry once again that, So, I tried to record this vlog earlier, and what happened was, for some reason the uploader broke, because usually I record these vlogs right through YouTube. I allow YouTube access to my webcam, and I can upload directly to the site without having to go through any third, or don't have to go upload it, and then it uploads directly as I'm filming. The problem is, it looked like the uploader broke or something, because the vlog never got uploaded, and I tried to access it, and unfortunately when you record it directly through the YouTube server, you don't get a copy of it. So the vlog that I recorded for 50 minutes, gone. So, I was not too happy with that. But I thought I'd shoot this vlog to let you know that I am alive. barely. Pulled a few all-nighters, but I'm alive. And I'm just pulling up comments here. I'd be missing some comments that I were there last time. I'd be missing some comments. Because it's funny, because I do read them all when they come in, so, like, I could tell when people have deleted comments. That was so creepy. But yeah, sorry that I haven't been so active on YouTube. I've been lucky to find time to even watch YouTube, never mind make videos. It's school has just been nuts. With the, you know, the finals coming up next week. I only have 2 days where I have finals, but I have two finals in 1 day, so not looking forward to that too much. But pipe. I know I said I wouldn't do this again. I'm now reminded of why. Please go out. Thank you. That was not a smart idea. I wanted to make sure the entire bowl was lit, and I just blew hot coals all over my crotch. So, don't do that. So, yeah, finals are coming up next week. I have two finals in 1 day, two finals Monday, and then a final on Tuesday, and then I'm done for the week. I still got a bit of Christmas shopping to do, but I have an idea of what I'm going to get people, so that's good. Yay me. I figured out something for once. There was a meme going around, and I feel like I'm feeling mentioning it because it's pretty accurate. 18 to 22 years, when between the ages of 18 and 22 years, is like playing a video game after skipping the tutorial. Yeah. But with that, let's get on to the comments. Mark left a comment saying, I greet you from the other side of the net, web, this vlog, because if I were on the side you were on, I'd be there and not here. So now that I've greeted you with those greetings and salutations, let us get into this. First, let me say, cool Boston Beans that you won the bid on eBay for that racket. But then again, you were the only one up for it, weren't you? Yeah, I was the only one up for it. I have no idea why. It's a really good racket. And this light is really weird. I'm not this pale in person. It's so weird with the delay. This is so professional. So I guess it should stand to reason that it should go to you regardless of how much you bid. Unless you outbid anyone else who offered less. That is the way it works on eBay, isn't it? Like an auction, the item goes to the highest bidder. Now you and your banana boy will at least have that in common. Fairly nearly the same weapon of choice with which to do battle on the court. In more ways than one, because... because this is my racket of choice, like I said before, the Wilson Pro Staff RF97 autograph. And what's funny is, I'm going to do actually a side-by-side comparison on this vlog, right there being his racket of choice. The Wilson Pro Staff 97S, and my racket right here. Can you tell them apart? So, we basically look like we have the same racket on court with our rackets of choice, and now we have, you know, these other two rackets in common. He has a different. He hasn't really the latest model. And I have the one that mine came out in 2007. It was made in 2007. That's when mine came out, or this particular model of the racket that I use came out. His is the latest model that came out, I think, 2013, 2014, I believe. So, yeah, his is relatively new. So, mine has a stiffer beam. Mine has a higher swing weight. So, that's why I preferred mine, because I typically enjoy a really heavy racket or heavy-feeling racket. So, I like the high swing weights. So yeah, we basically have not only the same fooling around racket, but the same racket of choice too. Except he has a different string pattern. His is a 18-17, mine's a 16-19. Yeah, because he has the S version. Do let us see it when it arrives. I'm gonna flash this through the entire vlog because I love it so much. I love holding it so much. It feels like perfect. Exactly the same as my racket, almost. Actually, let me compare them. Oh, there we go. Yeah, basically almost the same. You can feel like the slightly hot, like more, very, very slight difference, but yeah, I love that thing. It feels almost perfect. Actually, it is perfect. I love it. I love that kind of headlight. 12 ounces plus racket, you know, it has over, you know, racket 12 ounces, about 12 ounces, headlight balance, swing rate, swing weight above 330, that's a perfect racket for me. I will love it. Tonight, you're smoking an altogether different cigar, the Room 101. I have to say why, even though that Dutch Master Palmer was not to your liking, you did look good puffing on it, and your nose exhales were something to see. I like watching you smoke your cigars, but shh, don't tell anyone. Too late. So is this the time you start looking at grad school? Yes, unfortunately, this is about the time you start looking. Actually, it turns out I have like 5 or 6 semesters left of school. So, about 3.5 more years. About 3 more years after this semester. to go before I graduate. Yay. I can't believe it's been over a week since my last vlog, actually. I can't believe I'm done smoking. Time to repack the pipe. The retrohales are a very good thing to do if you are a cigar smoker, because it does bring out, like I said, it enhances the flavor. So I do try to retrohale as often as I can. Well, not as often as I can, but at least a few times when I'm smoking. Just to get the general, just to see if it brings out any more flavors. Or at least, what's called passively retrohaling, which is keeping your sinuses open, and naturally some will actually retrohale through them. And I packed it too tight. Let's hope. So, yeah, so now it's the time to look at grad school. And, the second you get into, for a science grad, the second you get into undergrad is basically the time they stop pounding grad school into your head. It's like, you're not even there for a semester before they're already pounding grad school into your head and saying and start bringing that up. So yeah, grad school is already on the menu. It's already on the docket. Don't you have like another 2.5 years left where you at? Where you're at? Yeah, like I said. Second you get in for science grad, your grad school is pounded into your head. I went to community college, not a major university. Well, if you want to count Florida University, is it Florida University? As a university. Learned a lot of stuff from going, and even got a good hazing, too, from my frat brothers. Such a bad bunch of boys. Another sucky Sunday at the old gas station, huh? That would irritate me to have to come in and do someone else's job, especially when I had plenty of my own to be responsible for. But you can't wait to clock out at the end of your shift. I cannot wait to clock out of that place. When I get home, I am frustrated beyond belief. But actually, another quick update is I have a girlfriend as well. She probably won't ever appear in the vlogs, mostly because she is incredibly camera shy. But I do have a girlfriend. And she was there this Sunday. She stayed with me at work. And she can now attest to why I hate my job. As I rant nonstop when there was no customers in the store. So yes, that's another thing that's happened is I actually got a girlfriend now. I went on a couple dates and we really hit it off, and so I am now out of the single pool. So that's very nice. But who knows, one day when you're creating papers as the most overqualified high school teacher, you'll look back on the road that got you where you are and think to yourself, boy, was it all worth it? Not. Yeah, cleaning chili pots that are 3 days old or 2 days old, or cleaning out milk and cream containers that haven't been cleaned out in 2 days, not worth it. Dumpster diving, not worth it. Because that's also what we used to have to do at the job back before I took that 1 year off. The dumpster used to get very full. And we used to have to, I don't remember if I ever did it, but we used to have to like throw in like cardboard, like lay out some cardboard in the dumpster, then jump on the cardboard to pack the dumpster down. And I'm like, to walk continuously asking ourselves, is this worth minimum wage to dumpster dive? And the most common answer was no. Sorry, I had to get the pipe going again. I too am looking forward to the next family outing vlog. And if you can smoke, okay. If not, that's okay too. But since you said you liked Swisher Sweets and the wine-flavored Black & Milds, working in a gas station, you should be able to get those easily. After all, they don't call them gas station cigarillos for nothing. Yeah. I mean, that's why I have them. That's why I've had them before. Believe it or not, some customers actually smoke the cigars at the gas station. Not all of them take the tobacco out and roll a blunt. Which I've seen, or not seen, but I've seen the funny, well, not seen, but Some customers will buy those Dutch Master Palmas, those big ones, take the tobacco out, and roll basically a huge joint. Which I'm like, okay. You're going to set the new standard for high, but for a high, but, pipes. Fun to smoke when you don't have to talk. When you have to talk, not so fun. It's really fun, Matthew. So, yeah, the reason why I've had those cigars and cigarillos, I've had nearly all of them there. Some customers will actually smoke them for the tobacco in them, which is weird because, I mean, the Dutch Master Palma is about $2. For $2, you can go down to a tobacco store and get a cheap premium, or premium-like cigar, with long filler. That's actually not so bad. Like, the Casa de Garcia is leaps and bounds ahead of a Dutch Master, or leaps and bounds ahead of a game. Not the greatest cigar, but comparatively, pretty damn good. So, so they'll ask me what my recommendations are sometimes. So I decided to try all the cigars there and cigarillos. Mistake, but Well, the only two that I could, well, the Black and Milds weren't bad. Neither were the Swisher Sweets. And the only reason why I typically don't smoke the Black and Milds is because I don't typically like tipped cigars. But. Yeah. So. Yeah. So I've liked those the wines Black Mouth. And would you do it? And would you do a tip? On I liked those best. I never liked the non-tip cigarillos because you get tobacco in your mouth. Yeah, because the problem with that non-tip cigarillos is since. They are short filler. They will some of that filler does come out quite easily. If you really want to avoid tobacco in your mouth, avoid Backwoods. Yeah, I can do a tip version of a wine, Black and Mild, or just a regular Black and Mild. If I was going to do a tip, I prefer the wood tip, just because I don't particularly care for plastic. Because I will smoke down to the very end of a tipped cigarillo, just because I can, since there is a tip. And burning plastic is not good. So I will, I'll do a wood tip Black and Mild wine sometime. But yet, it's in your mouth from premiums too. But personally, I would like to see you smoke a tip one. If you could do it in your cigar blog repertoire. Heck, if you do it. Heck, if you can't do it. On the trip, light one up in a vlog for us. sometime before you go back to your beloved Blanco Nines. Yeah, I'll definitely do one before I go back to the Blanco Nines. Too bad your friends are camera shy and won't let you get their smoking on video for us. But I respect that. I'm still not sure about putting my face out there too often either. That's why I will make seconds brief just to get a glimpse of what's going on here on my end. And also, I liked how you will smoke indoors, whereas I see a lot of videos of smoking outdoors or in cars. But maybe it's because the smoker doesn't want to fill their living space with great aromatic scent of cigars. Sorry, my phone just went off saying it's fully charged. Thank you. Sure, I would have figured that out. Well, I do know that cigar obsession reason why he doesn't smoke inside. Not because he doesn't like the smell of cigars in his house, but mostly because his wife doesn't. to each their own. But also, I can't fault him much. He lives in Florida. And, Mark, I believe that you're still from... Correct me if I'm wrong, but you're in Florida. If I lived in Florida, I would smoke outside all the time. Because trust me, weather in New England is not friendly to smokers. Yeah, if you're a smoker in New England, you're basically forced to smoke inside. at least 6 months out of the year. So, because it gets cold sometimes. Which actually right now we've had a pretty easy winter, which we kind of earned after last winter. Because last winter it was actually warmer in Alaska than it was here. It was warmer in Alaska than it was in Boston. So, White, I gotta ask you, do you need a comb for the stash of yours? You got some runaway nose hairs bugging you? Yes, I do sometimes need to comb it. Unfortunately. Some things you almost don't want to admit. Yes, I need to comb my mustache sometimes. So if I try an Avo cigar, the retro tail won't burn as much. Not any of the Avo classics, and not the Avo, begins with an M. It's an orange tube. It has an orange band. Those don't burn at all. So give it a try on the retro hail with that. It'll definitely help bring out some flavors, some more flavors from the cigar. So, I made note of the sticks that you recommended, so I'm going to check those out. But to leading into your question for this vlog, I do not buy in bulk or bundles because I don't smoke that many that often. So when I do, I pick up maybe one or two I'd like to try and just keep them in a sealed bag with water pellets. I think it is in there until I get ready to smoke them. But it's pretty quickly afterwards, since After they had taken out of the store, they start to lose the humidification, am I right? And since I don't have a humidor, I don't buy from out-of-state companies that sell them. But who knows, maybe one day my roommate and I will get a little deeper into the hobby and go in together and get a modest humidor. Good humidor manufacturer is Quality Importers, I believe. Yeah, Quality Importers. They usually make a pretty good humidor. If you're looking for one. I will be hitting the sack fairly early tonight, as I am especially tired and the cold is starting to wear on my body. I need to stay ahead of that since so many close to me are fighting cold right now. And once I get the sniffles, I'm down. So have a great rest of your night. Don't stay up too late smoking and vlogging, but you can a little. As always, such a pleasure to come and see another Wyatt one. Sweet smoky dreams, buddy Mark. Thank you, Mark. If you don't want to invest money in a humidor, there is a couple options for that. And probably the cheapest one, especially if you're not buying in giant quantities, is to do what's called I have no idea what it's called. But it's made pretty simply. Oh, shoot. One second. Okay, so yeah, there's a cheap option. Let me just think of... there's a cheap option, and it's a... Alright, I don't know what it is. But you basically take a Ziploc bag, and, like you were doing, and you can just throw in Boveda packs into it, and just seal it up like a Ziploc bag. That usually does the job. Throw in a little gauge in there. That's the way, sometimes is the best way to do it. If you need to travel, yeah, so if you want to just create a cheap solution to a humidor, or just a few, if you're a few sticks, like a 5-pack or something, just get a big Ziploc bag, throw in a couple of Boveda packs into it. Actually, you probably only need one Boveda pack, and a gauge. Simple. Really simple solution to the problem. Or if you want another cheap alternative, build a coolidor. There's plenty of videos online of how to build one. It's pretty simple. It's literally a cooler, a humidification device, and that's it, a gauge. Yeah, so look up a, yeah, you can do that thing with a plastic bag, or if you could use a coolidor. Also, there's certain types of cigars that you actually don't need a humidor for, believe it or not. There's cigars that come in, like you've seen the glass tubes that some of the, they're basically glass or hard plastic tubes with like a cork seal on them. That seal is good enough to keep the humidity in for a good amount of time, to the point where you don't really need a humidor if you're going to smoke them within a week of each other. At least that's what I've heard. That's at least what I've heard about them. So you can go ahead and try that. So there's a few options out there, so you don't have to buy a really expensive humidor. But if you do probably quality importers, I think that's a company makes pretty good humidors. At least it makes the one that I'm using right now that's working so much better than my bigger one that I still need to work on. Then Rory left a comment on that vlog. He says, "Hi Wyatt, well I'm glad to hear you had a good day outside of work Sunday, and being left with some undone duties, which probably would have made me a little impatient too. But on the plus side, you got that racket you bid on, and that sounds exciting. Now you have something to beat or try to beat Banana Boy with when you play against him again." Yeah. Hopefully. I need to turn around the record so far. He's beaten me the last like 5 times in a row, so I need to turn that record around. Need to stop pulling some more wins. So no gas stations or gas free tonight? No, avoiding them at all costs. Besides the Citrus Sweets and besides the Black and Milds, that's it. You may be the most overqualified high school teacher, but you'll definitely be the most interesting one. What with the field of interest in your personal life? Do I need to rattle them off, or do you have an idea of what I'm talking about? So you have a friend. So you and a friend have an upcoming reunion next week. Yep. We had to postpone it to this Saturday, but we've already gotten together a couple times. And yeah. And now we're dating. So I'm very happy about that. She and I are dating. But we had to postpone the first her first cigar, so she's gonna try she's gonna have her first cigar with me, so it should be interesting to see what happens. I mean, it can't get much better. I make sure like everything's quality control with these cigars, and they're in a really properly done up humidor, and they're properly acclimated, and they're 15 year age tobacco, and basically this is as good as it's gonna get. Yeah, so meaning you and I'm gonna change all the him and he pronouns into her, just cause it's, now that I've let you guys know, it is a her. It's kind of weird to read it as a him. Meeting you and her getting together. Yep. Hope that goes well and fun for both of you. Perhaps if she likes cigars too, you can smoke together, which is always nice. Yeah, I definitely look forward to smoking with her. Hopefully she likes them. So your mom was there the day that you went into the city. You just didn't get to see her. I wasn't aware that your sister was that young, so maybe because you didn't mention it before, maybe you didn't, I missed it, but yeah, being a new driver would be cause for heightened concern. So now we know why the extra buckling up, but I do believe, I heard you mention your own driving habits. Drive just a little fast. Which is kind of hilarious, because I've never gotten pulled over for driving too fast. I did get pulled over for doing a California roll through a stop sign. And in case you're unaware of what that is, I actually got pulled over last week for it. And my license plate light was out. which was kind of annoying. So what a California roll is, or a Massachusetts roll, whatever they want to call it, is when you just slow down when you go to a stop sign so that way you can look, and then you keep going. You don't come to a full and complete stop, which is what you're supposed to do. And I didn't. I saw that nobody was coming in both directions on my way up there, and just rolled right through it. Well, kind of, yeah, basically rolled right through it. Which is kind of ridiculous because I was taking a right, and it was kind of a weird street. So there was a street coming this way, and there's another street that kind of yields onto it like that. And it's basically almost like a yield, except they put a stop sign there. So it's a it should have, for all intents and purposes, I yielded. it was a stop sign there, and not long after going through it, blue lights flashing in the background. So, but got off with a warning, so that was good. I was very happy about that. And this pipe is never... So, yeah, I mean, I don't get it. I haven't gotten into an accident lately. I haven't gotten into an accident. So, I mean, knock on some form of wood. But, yeah, so, I have good technical skills driving. but in terms of necessarily following the laws when driving, speaking of your family, as for your relationship with your dad, that is between you and him. My dad and I didn't get along or have the best father-son relationship. Now I wish we had, so hopefully in time things will change for the two of you. And you will be driving to the next getaway. You will be driving to the next getaway then. That should be fun. As for whether you smoke at the end of the trip down the mountain or outside, which you don't like doing, is entirely up to you. I'm just eager to see the next Toll family outing. I definitely am going to vlog on this trip, so you guys will be able to tag along with me on this vacation. I don't know if I'll upload during the vacation, but I will upload definitely after it. And I'm bringing my GoPro along so that way I can film some of the slope, some of the trails we do, which should be interesting because they have one of my favorite trails there. It's probably one of the fastest trails that you go down. It's a double black diamond, which is the highest difficulty terrain. And it is fast. It is fast. There's no slow on that trail. In order to make it down at all, you gotta be really aggressive with the mountain. You gotta really dig your edges in to make the turns, and part of it, from what I hear, is a no fall zone, which I believe it because it is really steep. What I've heard is that it's a no fall zone. Which means basically you fall and you're not stopping till you hit the bottom. Okay, I give up. I give up with this bike! It was fun while it lasted. Not so much fun anymore. So, yeah, it's definitely going to be fun. I'll definitely vlog that trail. Use the GoPro on that trail. That should be fun. He says, you learned to ski at an early age, 11. No accidents or broken legs?
Nope.
The worst fall I had was probably when I was 12, 13. Because that's... Let's put it this way. No matter what activity you do, you always hit that eight, that point where you think you're the shit, and you think that you're the best that there ever was or ever will be at what you're doing. So you kind of overestimate yourself a little bit. I hit that about 12 or 13. And had a good wipeout. I ended up, you know those ski... there's little, like, almost, they're poles. Not the ski poles you ski with, but they're the kind of, like, trail marker poles. I ended up skiing right into one, straddling it, flipping over, spinning out, skis gone, gloves gone, poles, boots, well, not boots, but hat, goggles, snow everywhere. Really, I whacked my knee off the pole, so that really hurt, but, yeah, good yard sale, which is, yeah, a yard sale is when you lose basically everything. Lost my gloves, lost my hat, lost my goggles, skis, poles, just lining the mountain during the entire, like, wipeout slide, just all my gloves going up the mountain. So, yeah, that was probably my worst accident, and then I did ski off a cliff once, which, it wasn't a sheer cliff, but it was close enough where you'd call it a cliff. It was about like that. Now, that's, believe it or not, is probably skiable in the snow. But when it's rock, that's basically a cliff. And I skied off of it. I was skiing in a glade, which is tree skiing. It was a marked glade, so, you know, it was a sanctioned glade, you know, we were able to ski there. You're skiing through trees. And, it was probably an exit for the glade when there was more snow. So that's why there was paths leading off of it. Because when there's more snow, obviously that terrain would be skiable. But when there's not snow, it becomes basically a cliff. And, quite a rocky cliff. And, so there wasn't a lot of snow, and there was a little dip before the cliff, so you couldn't, and it was kind of a clearing, and kind of the sun is in your face when you're just coming out of the trees. So I dipped down and went up, you know, it went to down the dips right before it, and, came up, basically came right up and off the cliff. It's like, shit. And you know those Wile E. Coyote moments where, you know, you don't realize that the gravity doesn't start working until after you realize you're not standing on anything anymore? I had one of those moments where you just kind of look and you go, this is going to hurt. So I skied off that. Luckily, I didn't fall off it. I didn't ski off of it enough where I didn't have access to grabbing onto the cliff. So I basically grabbed on the cliff and found a good place to kind of rest my skis as I'm holding on to keep falling down. Because like I said, it wasn't a sheer cliff, but it was all rock. I mean, I probably wouldn't have fallen, you know, you're not going to fall straight down. But I am going to just keep bouncing off this rock face on the way down. So, luckily, I didn't fall more than 2 feet. Because I didn't go up that dip very fast, but I kind of just went, whoop. Oh, shit. And I was able to grab the cliff, and basically, you know, there was a rock that I had to rest my skis on, and since it wasn't a sheer cliff, I wasn't having to hold on with all my body weight there. And eventually somebody came, and I threw my ski poles up back on the cliff. Luckily somebody came, who was about to make the same mistake I did. And luckily I'm sitting there shouting while I'm holding onto the cliff, Hey, there's a cliff here! Don't ski off this! And luckily he heard me, he stopped. And then he helped me back up onto the slope. So, yeah. So, I've had some incidences when skiing. But luckily, I haven't broken anything. So, I'm not into playing in the snow, so I don't think I'll be learning. I don't think learning how to ski at this juncture in my life is a priority. Staying alive as long as I can to wreak havoc on somebody is all I care about. Well, that and living for my cats. Thanks for doing the retro trails. Those were really cool to see. And yes, I like the way you blew smoke out of the side of your mouth. That like that. That is so cool. And if rings are not easy for you, don't do them for me. But if someone else requests them and you wish to honor it, by all means. Sorry. It is your smoke. That trick you sold, is it that the one you let your friend drive into you in the Epic Mad Science intro? Yes, that is the truck that drove into me during the Epic Mad Science intro. Yeah, puts into perspective how good that hit was. Felt like getting hit by a professional linebacker. Yeah. I would have thought you'd have gotten more for it than what you said, but maybe you were really trying to unload it. Yes, at that point, I was kind of desperate to just get rid of it. And the reason is because I list the problems that it had. The head gasket was blown, so it was constantly overheating because coolant was leaking into the cylinders. So the check engine light was always on. And like I said, it was constantly running out of coolant. The one of the headlights were out. The driver's side window didn't roll down. The body was starting to rot more than what I can keep up with body work. The side step to the driver's side fell off. Fall off to the point where you couldn't stand on it. It was just kind of bouncing and hanging there. But you couldn't take it off because all the rest of the bolts were rusted on. So we had that. What else was wrong? The battery was basically dead and wouldn't hold the charge. Which we found out that day. Yeah, that's what was wrong with my truck. And what happened that day when we were selling it, we jumped the truck to get it started. We had to jump it like 3 times just before it would move. We got it to move, and then, by the time we got it to move, and then the customer on the way back attempted a 3-point turn to just turn around because we were on my street and he didn't want to drive it around the block. He just wanted to drive it up and down the street. So he attempted a three-point turn, and the truck died in the middle of the three-point turn, blocking the street. That's a great first impression. So we had to drive a car over there, jump it again, and then it died another time in the middle of the three-point turn. It basically died every time he shifted gear. So every time he went from drive to reverse, it died, and every time he went from reverse to drive, it died. So we had to jump it all through that three-point turn. Till finally, we got it back to where we were parking it to sell it. And then, finally we did get, and finally I was just like, thinking to myself, whatever he offers, I'm going to take, because it's getting to the point where this is ridiculous. So he offered $600. I'm like, it's yours. yeah. So yeah, that's why I only got $600 for it. He got a $600 paperweight, as far as I'm concerned. but I did love driving that truck, man. As soon as I don't have to commute as much, I'll probably get a pickup truck again. I'm glad that the vlogs bring you as much joy as they do for me. As I ponder many of the comments that I have shared, I think I should tone down the stranger ones a wee bit and present a more serious note on the remark to the subject of the vlog which you present. But it can be hard to pull back sometimes when comedy is so much a part of one's personality. No, you don't have to pull back at all. I love the kind of... I actually do love the weird things that you put in your comments, because I do love weird comments, just because because they're not as serious, and I don't pretend to be a very serious person, so, yeah, I love, like, the weird little things that you throw in the comments, so you don't have to tone that back any, they're fine, yeah, so, I don't know, keep it up. If you want to change, but if you feel like you have to, that you don't. So so with that said, on to the question of this vlog. I purchased my cigars at my local cigar and smoke lounge, or the discount shop, both of which have walk-in humidors. I usually buy them fairly close to when I'm wanting to smoke them, so they're not sitting around outside a good humidor, of which I do not own. I use a Tupperware or sealed Tupperware container system, but really have that many on hand to worry about them going bad. In the last question you asked about our disappointing cigar, and I said it was the Black Onyx, I did a video on that some time ago, but deleted it because I was so unhappy with the cigar and the video that I did away with both. And the cigar, I didn't even get through the first third before tossing it. It was just that bad. So on that note, I just take my leave from this commenting and await your next vlog. As always, remember to savor your smoke, Rory. Thank you, Rory, for your comment. So as you've seen, my humidor, I use, right now I'm using the Quality Importers, I think it's a 20 count humidor. I have both heartfelt humidity beads, which I recommend to no end, because they're a two-way, I always recommend two-way systems, for humidification, because, and two-way systems both absorb humidity and release humidity, to a certain, point. Like, Bovita packs do that, heartfelt beads do that, and, also, the Cigar Oasis to some extent. The Cigar Oasis actually is really good about that. And sorry about that. And, so yeah, but I love the heartfelt beads. You can buy them for, you can buy them in little tubes, and in different percentages. I have them in 65%. You can buy them in 67 and a bunch of other, ones. You can buy them, like I said, tubes. You can buy them in pound bags, half pound bags. Yeah, they're really good, for what they do. Also the, I use an active, humidification device, whereas the heartfelt beads are passive, and same thing with Bovida packs are passive, and most are passive. I do use a cigar oasis, which is an active humidification device. It has a fan in it that kicks on when the humidity drops below what you set it at. So I have mine set at 65. So when the humidity drops below 65, the fan kicks on and blows more humidity into the humidor from the humidification device that is attached to the cigar oasis. And like I said, I just used the humidor, the Quality Importers humidor that I've shown in the blog. And I have a few other humidors. So now, on to the question of this vlog. What is the cigar that you're looking forward to trying the most? That you haven't tried yet. So, yeah. Let me know in the comment section down below. And I will see you guys in the next vlog. Bye.